Press record. Okay, we are recording now. And share the screen. Okay, we're good to go. Okay, so we're on the 2.2. I did a lot of 2.2 yesterday. We'll do more. And I'm hoping at the end of class today, we'll finish 2.2. And then I'll give you something to do in class also for today. And mind you, we have a short week. So your quiz this week will be on Thursday. Again, Friday and Monday are holidays. No school Friday, no school Monday. Okay. So if I'm able to finish 2.2 today, then it looks like I'm a day ahead. But that's good. I mean, I might fall behind later, or, you know, like I said, it's good to be ahead in case something happens. I might get sick or my internet goes down or whatever. So I'm a little bit ahead. Mentioned before, very, very rarely when I make out the schedule do I keep it. It's almost 100% guaranteed I don't keep the schedule, you know, perfectly. It just doesn't work that way, as you know. Okay. All right. So let's go back to where we were. Okay, so I did a lot of this stuff. I think I did most of 4 through 18. I think I'll do one more from here, and I'll try to knock off a lot of the rest, 19 and 27, 31 and 41. Now, a lot of these are calculator dependent, okay? So you should punch a lot of these in your calculator. I have already done them ahead of time. I don't want to normally spend a whole lot of class time you watching me punch stuff in a calculator. You can do it on your own. You can punch it out on your own, okay? So if I say, here's an expression, punch it in the calculator. I've already pre-done it to save a little time and say, here's the answer, right? So it says, oh, you're supposed to plug into, I don't know, x squared plus 11x minus 30 or whatever. And, you know, I've done it. So I did it ahead of time and here's the result. But of course, you want to go back and check that you do it, that you can do it yourself. But rather than spending class time for that kind of stuff, I would just, you know, go right to it. Okay, so we're going back to doing a lot of this kind of stuff. Okay, so first problem I wanted to start today was 11. Where am I? Page 93. So you have a piecewise defined function. Okay, sketch the graph and use it to determine the values of a for which the limit as x approaches a of f of x exists. Okay, now when you get a piecewise defined function, there's a good chance the limit's not going to exist, in particular at negative 1 and 1, because that's where the graph breaks, right? So this is linear, that's pretty smooth, that's parabolic, and that's also linear, right? So if there's gonna be any jump, if there's gonna be any gap, it would most likely be between negative 1 and 1, okay? So let's see what the graph of this thing looks like. Okay, so 2.2 number 11. Okay, so 1 plus x, that's linear. For x less than negative 1, strictly less than negative 1, you don't have the line underneath it, right? Okay, so if I do plug in negative 1, I get 0, so an open circle at negative 1, 0. And the slope is 1, so just going down like that at a 45 degree angle. Okay, between negative 1 and 1, x squared. Well, I know that's parabolic, looks like that. Closed circle here. Now, you have to pretend there's an open circle there. Temporarily pretend it's open if I'm looking only at the parabolic part, okay? So negative 1 comma 1, closed circle, 1 comma 1, open circle, okay? So that's open temporarily. And why is it closed up? Because of this part, 2 minus x, x is greater than or equal to 1. So now when I plug in 1, I follow this root, 2 minus 1, it's 1, so it gets closed up. And I know the slope is negative 1, so it drops at a 45 degree angle. So there's the graph. Okay, so now the question is, for what values of x will the two-sided limit exist? Limit from the left and limit from the right are the same. Well, the only trouble spot is right here at negative 1. Okay, so the limit as x approaches negative 1 from the left, by coming this side, looks like I'm near 0. The limit as x approaches negative 1 from the right is over here at 1, okay? But everywhere else, the two-sided limit exists. Okay, so if I pick a point like there, two-sided limit exists, and there, and even right here, two-sided limit exists, two-sided limit, okay? So the limit as x approaches a, two-sided of f of x exists for all reals except for negative 1, or you can write it as all real numbers, the funny looking R, minus the set consisting of negative one. Okay, so right at negative one, the limit from the left does not match the limit from the right, because when I come on the left side, the y values are near zero. If I come from the right side, the y values are up around one. Okay, but everywhere else, it looks like the two-sided limit exists. Okay, that's how that one works. Okay. All right, so that's that. Now, and for a lot of these other ones, so 19 to 27, 31 to 41. They give you some expression, like look at 19. Guess the value of the limit if it exists by evaluating the function of given numbers corrected six decimal places. It's really just plug and chug. Plug all these numbers in. Plug all these numbers in. Trying to find the limit as x approaches 3. Okay, so notice what's happening. These top numbers, x is approaching 3 from the right. We're getting very close to 3 coming from the right side. 3.1, 3.05, 3.01, 3.0001. The bottom numbers were approaching 3 from the left. 2.9, 2.99, 2.9999, right? So look at the progression of the function values here, the y coordinates, and here, do you approach any one number? That's the idea. Same thing for 21. Limit as t approaches zero of e to the 5t minus 1 divided by t. Okay, and they have the plus or minus. Now, they're not saying that you get the same thing when you plug in a positive or a negative. In fact, in this case, I know you don't. It's not a symmetric function. Okay, but those are numbers you plug in. So negative 0.5, negative 0.1, negative 0.0001, you're getting very close to zero coming from the left. Look at those function values. Then positive 0.5, 0.1, 0.01, point whatever, 0.001, you're getting very close to zero coming from the right. So the function value at zero does not exist, but maybe the two-sided limit does exist. See, so that's the idea. Okay, so I did 23 for you in its entirety. So let me show you a little bit of that. In fact, 23, they don't give you the list of numbers. You have to make up your own. So you do have the advantage here. They tell you what to plug in. 23, they don't tell you what to plug in, so you plug in your own. So use a table of values to estimate the value of the limit. And if you have a graphing device, blah, blah, blah. Okay, limit as x approaches 4 of ln x minus ln 4 divided by x minus 4. Okay, notice you're not allowed to plug in 4, but you are allowed to plug in numbers that are very close to 4. And that's the idea. Okay, so here we go. All right, so limit as x approaches 4. Let me raise it up. I should raise this up also in case you didn't catch the graph part. You can watch the video later, of course. All right, limit as x approaches 4, natural log of x minus natural log of 4 divided by x minus 4. This is two-sided. There's no minus or plus. So you should have numbers coming from the left. So I put 3.9, 3.99, 3.999. And I had numbers coming from the right side, getting very close to 4 coming from the right. 4.1, 4.01, 4.001, stuff like that. Okay. Now, the reason why I put parentheses is that if you're typing all this in one fell swoop, you should put parentheses here by order of operations. Okay. In other words, you should put parentheses ln 3.9 minus ln 4 divided by parentheses 3.9 minus 4 and so on. Okay. And this is what I get in the table, okay? Maybe willing just to show you one of them, okay? Just so you can see what it is. Okay, so let me plug in 3.9, but I'm not gonna do all of them. Okay, so parentheses, ln 3.9 minus ln 4, parentheses divided by parentheses 3.9 minus 4. Okay, so here's how I typed it in. Let me get it to you all together. So parentheses, ln 3.9, the x, right? You're plugging in 3.9, 3.99. So here's 3.9. ln 3.9, right? Minus ln 4 divided by parentheses 3.9 minus 4. So please notice the extra parentheses, 0.2532 roughly, something like that. Okay. Then I did the same thing, plugged in 3.99, 3.999, and 4.1, 4.01, 4.001. Okay. And maybe I'll just show you 4.1, just for fun. Okay, 4.1, sorry. Put 4.1 there, 4.1 there. So natural log of 4.1 minus natural log of 4, parentheses, parentheses, divided by parentheses, 4.1 minus 4. 0.2469, blah, 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 blah. Okay, same thing here, same thing here. And raise it up for focusing. Okay, so what do you notice about these numbers? Look at this progression here, we're getting very close to, it looks like 0.25 or 1/4, right? So we will say limit as x approaches 4 of natural log of x minus natural log of 4 divided by x minus 4 looks to be about 0.25 or 1/4. Okay. Okay, then I was going to show you 27. Let's see, where'd it go? Limit as x approaches 0 from the right of x to the x power. It's only one-sided. Okay, so that means I don't have to plug in negative 0.1, negative 0.01, negative 0.001. Okay, so you only have to come from one side because of the plus. If there was a minus, you'd only come from the left side. So here I go. I said 0.1, 0.01, 0.001. And this is what I got. Okay. Now this one's easy enough that I can just show you some of them. So 0.1 raised to the 0.1, right? 0.7943, whatever. And the last one I'll show you, quick, 0.001. Raised to the 0.001, 0.993. That seems like it's about one. So the guess is limit as x approaches 0 from the right of x to the x power is 1. Okay. And just for fun, how about I go 0.00001 raised to the 0.00001. I didn't write it on a table, but that's getting even closer to zero coming from the right. Right? So let's see how this comes out to be. Look, it's even closer, right? 0.99988, blah, 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 blah. Okay. So I'm guessing if I did 0.00001 raised to the whatever I just said, it'd be even closer to one. And so on. So that's what we got. Now, of course, at this time, you might be saying, this is very tedious. Yes, it is. Is there a better way to do these without keep punching it in the calculator? The answer is yes, and we'll get to that starting the next section. There are algebraic ways that you can get some of these limits and not have to mess with all this kind of stuff. Although some cases, you don't have any choice, but we'll see. Okay, 31. Limit as x approaches 5. The plus means coming from the right. And the plus doesn't necessarily mean a positive or a negative. In this case, it's positive. Even if there was a minus sign, I'm plugging in positive values, right? The minus would mean coming from the left. So that'd be like 4.9, 4.99, 4.999. They're still positive values. So the plus or minus doesn't mean positive or negative values. Please make sure you understand it. The minus means you're only coming from the left side. The positive means you're only coming from the right side. Okay. So coming from the right side means 5.1, 5.01, 5.001. Okay, and again, even though they write it like this in the book, when you type it all in one fell swoop, you should put parentheses. Okay. So in other words, it's going to be parentheses 5.001. I'll do with the last one, 5.001 plus 1. Oh, I could have done that in my head, 6.001. But anyway. Divided by parentheses 5.001 minus 5. So it's like that, right? So you should put parentheses around the entire numerator and around the entire denominator. Okay, 61, 601, 6001, it's blowing up, right? So the limit as x approaches 5 from the right of x plus 1 divided by x minus 5 is infinity. Okay. And you can see if I plug in 5.000001, it'd be even bigger. It would shoot up to infinity. Okay. I'm almost done with the section, except there's a couple that might be a little bit tricky. So let me address those. That would be 37 and 39 because they involve trig. And yes, I do see something in the chat. So I'll try to that also. So 37, how do I approach pi over 2 from the right? And 39, how do I approach 2 pi from the left? So let me see how you can do that. And while I'm at it, let me go, I think it's a good time. Let me check the chat real quickly. Okay. So some attendance, okay. All right, so I think we're caught up. Okay, so when do I write DNE? DNE does not exist. Okay, well, if you're asking for a function value and there's a hole, and there's no closed circle anywhere, then that would be DNE if it does not exist, okay? For some of the graphs, if you have a two-sided limit, if the two-sided limit isn't approaching the same value, so on one side it's way up here and the other side is way down here, then the two-sided limit does not exist also, okay? So those are possibilities too. Okay, let me address these here. And thank you, Prasanna. You can always ask questions and Prasanna will help me when possible. Limit as x approaches pi over 2 from the right. Now, I didn't do 37. I didn't do 39, but I'll just tell you how to set them up. Okay. First thing I notice is pi over 2 pi, those are radians. So when you're punching it in your calculator, make sure you have it in radian mode, not degree mode. So let me double check that I'm in the correct mode. Okay, so there I am, I'm in radian mode. Okay, so that's this, the third one down for me. There's radians, and that would be degrees, but right now I want radian mode. Okay, if you have a regular scientific calculator, like this one, if you have a scientific calculator, this DRG, does it D for degrees, so right now it's in degree mode. I hit it again, and it's in radian mode. G stands for gradients. We don't really do it that much. I'll just mention quickly off to the side, there are 400 gradients in one revolution. So 360 degrees is one revolution, 2 pi radians is one revolution, and 400 gradients. Okay, but let me go back to radians for this. So that's what DRG stands for, degrees, radians, and gradients. If you don't know what I said about gradients, don't worry about it. But in case anybody's curious, 400 gradients is one revolution. It kind of makes sense because that means instead of 90 degrees, you say 100 degrees for what we normally say is a 90 degree angle. That would be 100 gradients. Okay, you know, 100's a nice number. So anyway, now here's what you have to do. Pi over 2, what is pi over 2? 1.5707, blah, 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 right? So I wrote some of those digits in. So you're approaching from the right. So you're always taking a number that's bigger than pi over 2, but you're going farther and farther out. So here's what you should plug in. So if I go to the tenth place, a little bit bigger is 1.6, correct? Then the next one, 1.57 something, that means plug in 1.58. It's getting closer, right? And 1.5707, next one is 1.571. Next one, 1.57079 means 1.5708. And that should be good enough. Okay. All of these are bigger than pi over 2, correct? But we're getting closer, right? As I move this away, the numbers are smaller. 1.58 is smaller than 1.6. And that is smaller than that, and that's smaller than that. And we're getting closer and closer to pi over 2. Okay, so that's the hint for that one. Oh, and the other thing is, how do you type it on your calculator or computer? It says secant. Secant is the reciprocal of the cosine. So when you type it out, it should be 1 over parentheses x cosine x. Okay, make sure you're in radians. Okay, and then for the last one, 39, then I'm done with the section. And let's see, it's only 9:35, so I can sneak in a little of the next section and give you something to do in class. Limit as x approaches 2 pi of x cosecant of x. All right, now you can't type cosecant because there's no button for cosecant. So cosecant is the reciprocal of the sine. So you're going to go x divided by sine x. And x approaches 2 pi from the left. Okay, so you need a rough decimal approximation of 2 pi. 6.28318, whatever. So we're getting closer to 2 pi from the left. So I just take each digit as it comes along. So I plug in 6, 6.2, 6.28, 6.283, right? These are all smaller than 2 pi, but we're getting closer, right? It's getting bigger, right? 6.2 is bigger than that. That's bigger than that, that's bigger than that, and so on. So that's how you plug in these things here. That might be easier to understand than this one. Okay. But you have to just think of the number line. Okay. All of these numbers are bigger than pi over 2, right? 1.6 is bigger. So it's almost like you just go to the next digit and add 1 to it. So 1.58, 1.571, 1.5708, and so on. Okay, and here you can just take the digits as they come. So 6 is definitely smaller than that. 6.2 is definitely smaller. 6.28 is definitely smaller. You just pick up the next digit as you go along. So this one's actually a little bit easier to do. Okay. All right, so I'm done with the section. I'll get started with the next section, which is 2.3. I'll do an introduction. Probably won't get that far. And let me check the chat as it is. How do you know when to plug in the x values? Okay, well, they will say coming from the left and coming from the right. Now, if they already give you the table, that's why I didn't bother doing any of these, because they told you specifically what to put in. So here is no brainer. X approaches 3. Okay, 3.1, 3.05, 3.0. Okay, if they didn't give me this, I would probably just, you know, go 3.1, 3.01, 3.001, 3.001, and so on. And the other side is 2.9, 2.99, 2.999. Okay. It's definitely harder though when they give you a weird number like, you know, pi over 2 or 2 pi. So there you need a decimal approximation. So it's only when they give you an irrational number like that that you have to do that digit scheme that I have. So something like 37 or 39. It certainly makes us much more uncomfortable, but the technique that I showed you, that's how you approach 37 and 39. Okay, and I think I've done everything I need to for 2.2. Okay, so I'll start 2.3 for a little while and then I'll stop after a certain amount of time and give you something to do in class. So 2.3, calculating limits using the limit laws. So what does that mean? Okay, so there are some properties of limits. Okay. And you might say to yourself already, I don't want to keep using my calculator and plugging in, you know, 0.1 and 0.01 and 0.001 and stuff like that, and 3.9 and 3.99 and 3.9999 and so on. So is there something better? The answer is yes. Okay. Usually it's algebraic. First, here are some limit laws. I don't think you have to put these on your formula sheet or your cheat sheet. Okay. They're very intuitive. They're sort of like what you would have thought would be the case. Okay. The limit of a function f of x plus g of x, you can just add the individual limits. Okay. In words, the limit of a sum is the sum of the limits. Okay. If I never showed you this and I just told you figure it out, you'd probably get it. Okay. So suppose it's a limit as x approaches 3, and there's x squared plus 5x, right? Or you just figure out the x squared and figure out the 5x and just add them up. Same thing for a subtraction. Same thing for a multiplication. Same thing for a division, as long as you're not dividing by 0, of course. And number 3, the limit of a constant times a function. Okay, c is a constant. If you have a constant times a function, the limit is the constant times the limit of the function. In other words, you can pass the c out in front of the limit. Okay, so number 1, we often say the limit of a sum is the sum of the limits. You want the limit of that plus that, just take the limit of that plus the limit of that. Same thing for a difference. Limit of a difference is the difference of the limits. And where am I? Page 95. The limit of a constant times a function, the limit of a constant times a function is the constant times the limit of the function, okay? So there's a 7 in front of the function. You could just factor out the 7, so to speak. It'll be 7 times whatever the limit of that is. The limit of a product is a product of the limits, okay? The limit of something times something, just take the limit of first times the limit of second. And the limit of a quotient is the quotient of the limits, provided the limit of the denominator is not equal to 0, of course. Okay. We will handle situations where the denominator is 0. In fact, we've already seen some of them, and we have certain laws involving that, as we shall see. Okay, there are power rules also. The limit of a function to the nth power is the limit of the function to the nth power. Okay. I say, do you have to write these down? No. In my opinion, you don't even have to memorize them. They're what you would have thought. So if you just go by your intuition, you'd probably get it. Okay. So it's like if you have the limit of x to the fifth power, you can just take the limit of x and then just raise it to the fifth power. Okay, limit of a constant function, limit as x approaches a of c is equal to c. It sounds weird, but it's like this limit x approaches a doesn't affect the c. So what's the limit as x approaches 5 of 24? Well, you don't care, 24 stays 24, whether x is approaching 7 or not, right? Okay, the limit as x approaches a of x is equal to a. Somewhat intuitive, I think. Limit as x approaches a of x is equal to a. Okay. It's sort of like saying when x gets close to 3, then x gets close to 3, right? That's really what's going on there. Okay, the limit as x approaches a of x to the n is a to the n. Okay. Again, don't memorize these. They're true, but you're just using these. The limit of an nth root. Just take the limit and take the nth root of that. Again, it's almost just like plugging in. Similar. The limit as x approaches a of the nth root of f of x is the nth root of the limit. In other words, you can pass the limit inside and outside of a radical. See how the limit can kind of sneak in? Okay. All right, so you could do a whole bunch of head spinning things through this. So let me show you this. Evaluate the following limits and justify each step. I'm not going to have you do that. Okay, so look at what they're doing here. The limit of all this stuff, x approaches 5. So they break it up into 2x squared here minus the limit as x approaches 5 of 3x plus the limit as x approaches 5 of 4. They took out the 2, they took out the 3. Okay, then they plugged in. You know what's easier? You just plug in. Just just plug in from the start. Just put a 5 right there and a 5 right there and you got it. Okay, so why go through all of this rigmarole here? Just plug it in. Okay. That's basically the direct substitution property, which says if you can plug in, do so. Okay. That sounds kind of weird and kind of obvious. A lot of the homework problems that we'll get later, it's not going to be that easy, believe me. Okay. Because otherwise it's just algebra one. Okay, so if you can plug in, do so, but a lot of the homework problems, you won't be able to do so. Okay. Okay, and let's see, what else did I need to show you? Okay, we will learn later something called the greatest integer function. Okay, that doesn't show up until problems at the end. I think it's like problem 52 or 53 or something like that. Yeah. I'll just introduce that to you and I won't go much longer. Greatest integer function. You write it funny like this. It's like two brackets. It's the largest integer that is less than or equal to x. Okay. So that means if you already have an integer, okay, what's integer? 0, 1, 2, 3, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, and so on. So if you already have an integer, it stays the same. If you have any fractional or decimal part, you always round down. You always go down. So greatest integer function of 4 is 4. Notice greatest integer function of 4.8 is 4, not 5. You do not round off. You always round down. You always go down. Greatest integer function of pi is 3, because pi is 3.141, blah, 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 right? So if you go down, it's 3. Greatest integer function of square root of two is like 1.414, so you go down to 1. Greatest integer function of negative a half, you go down to negative 1, okay? And this is what the greatest integer function looks like. Figure 6, where am I, page 101. Sometimes called a step function. So it looks like you're climbing up steps. Okay, so y equals greatest integer function of x. Let me just talk quickly about interval from 0 to 1. So greatest integer function of 0 is 0. Greatest integer function of 1 is 1. 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, negative 1, negative 1, negative 2, negative 2. Right? So again, if you already have an integer, it stays the same. But if you have any fractional part, you go down. So the greatest integer function of 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.5, 0.9, 0.99, 0.99999, they would all go down to 0. That's why it's like this. And then right at 1, you jump up to 1, right? The greatest integer function of 1 is 1. And then 1.1, 1.2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1.8, 1.9, 1.999, 1.99999, greatest integer function would go down to 1. And then right at 2, it jumps up to 2, and likewise. So it ends up looking like this. Okay, sometimes called a step function. Okay, all right. We have something called the squeeze theorem. We'll have occasion to use the squeeze theorem here and there. There aren't that many problems involving the squeeze theorem, okay? I'll just mention quickly, if you have a function squeezed between other two, so look at the picture, figure 7, look at the g function, right? G is stuck between f and h, and the two extreme functions, the h and the f, both approach the same limit. Then the one that's squeezed in would also approach the same limit. Because you have three functions, biggest one, smallest one, and the one in the middle, right? The red one stays between the green and the blue for the area that we're concerned with. Okay? And both function H and function F approach L, then the red being squeezed between the two would also have to approach L. Okay? So that's something called the squeeze theorem, and I'll tell you when we need it. Okay. All right, now, so what's gonna happen for a lot of these limits, and we'll talk about some of these eventually too, but if you have the opportunity of just plugging in, do so. Okay, so for number 3, it says evaluate the limit and justify, don't do that, just plug it in. Okay, they want you to say the limit of a sum is the sum of the limits, the limit of the product, you don't have to do all that, just plug it in. Okay, so this is basically algebra 1, right? Look at number 3. Plugging three there, three there, three there. You got it. Okay. Number seven. Number seven is not really that bad. Just plug it in. Eight. Okay, you'll get a real number. But obviously, they're not all going to be that easy. Okay, so if you look at number 11, right, you're dividing by zero. Number 13, you're dividing by zero. 17, you're dividing by zero. 15, I'm guessing you're dividing by zero if you plug in negative three. I don't see why, yeah, right? So what's going to happen there? Okay, you could make a table, but we don't feel like it for a lot of these. Okay, like negative two, right? You can't plug in negative two. That's not allowed. So what's going to happen is we'll do some algebra tricks. Okay, you have to do something with algebra in order to get the answer to these. Okay. All right, but so we'll start that tomorrow. That was just an introduction, and I'll stop there and give you something to do in class right now. Okay, so this is right off the book. If you don't have the book, you can take a picture if you wish. Okay, so in class right now, please go back to 2.2. I want you to do number five. Okay, 2.2, number five. I will hold it up for you right now. Okay, so do five, just put A, B, C, D, E, and either a number or D, N, E for does not exist. Okay, so once more, this is 2.2, page 92, number five. If you have the book, just go to it. You say, I already did the homework. Good, just type it in and you're done. You may leave. So five, there's the picture. I'll hold it up for maybe another 15 seconds. Take a picture or do a screenshot right now and do A, B, C, D, E, those limits. Looks like you've got A is a two-sided limit, B and C are one-sided, then D goes over two-sided, and then it says F of three. If you think the answer is D and E does not exist, then just put D and E. Okay, so when you type it in, again, do a private chat, just put A, the answer, then B, the answer, C, the answer, D, the answer, E, the answer, and then you can go. If you have any question, you can ask Prasanna or me. Okay, I'll hold it up just for a little bit longer because the book is heavy, as you know. So if you haven't already done it, please take a picture on your cell phone. Or if you have the book, just use the book. It's problem five on 2.2, page 92, or hit screenshot. Okay, so that is that. Okay, so I'll stop the share. I'll stop recording also.